Hello, fellow mapmakers. Welcome to tonight's live mapping session. I'm Ralf Schemmern of ProFantasy Software, and I want to show you a bit of working with Campaign Cartographer and Dungeon Designer tonight. Hope you're all doing good, having a nice Thanksgiving holiday if you're in a location where that is celebrated. I'm here in Germany, it's not one of our festive days, but I know quite a few people will be out there with their families, or perhaps a bit less than usual this year. Hope you're all doing good and fine and still enjoying the day. I want to show a bit of making battle maps today. The question has come up in some Facebook threads and on the forum recently of how to properly import Campaign Cartographer maps in virtual tabletops like Fantasy Grounds or Roll20. And I want to show a bit of that today so people can reference it. And I can't say I'm familiar with very many of the virtual tabletops, but I'll show you a couple. And from there, it should be easy to adapt to any other software environments. I've been using virtual tabletops myself a little lately with the lockdown here, or the partial lockdown in Germany. We've stopped our usual gaming group and turned to online gaming, and it's working quite nicely. And of course, it's nice if you have the occasional map to show your players in the virtual tabletop. So we'll have a look today how to do that with Campaign Cartographer. The process of exporting and importing the map itself is fairly quick and uncomplicated, so it's not enough material for a whole live mapping session. So what we'll do, we'll create a small battle map to start, so I can show you a bit more of the tools, and then at the end we'll import that into, or export it and import it into virtual tabletops. Good. So, as you can see, I already have played around a little bit with the map. I'm going to do something similar for my work that's coming. And I want to do something, an outdoor battle map, something with trees and stuff, not going to underground into a dungeon today. So, to start off, we're going to start a new map, going up to the File toolbar, to the File Operations button. Yep, this is the New Map button. Click that. Not going to save these changes to the map. And for the map type, we're going to go with the Dungeons, even if it's Overland. Any battle maps are usually subsumed in the Dungeons map styles, so that's where we go. And we could now go with the simply with the DD3's dungeon style, or one of the dungeon styles that are included in the base Campaign Cartographer, like the Helvin Wieling style. Oh no, Helvin Wieling's Overland style. Sorry about that. About the John Roberts dungeon style. But I'm going to go with one of the annual styles, because we do have a dedicated battle map style in there. Basically, this is just a little extra prepare templates based on the Dungeon Designer 3 style. So all the symbols and stuff will be from Dungeon Designer anyway, except for a few extra ones from the annual. And what the template shows is it has some setup commands right here when you start the new map, because it suggests some paper sizes that you might want to print your paper your battle map with, and this will be useful for us as well later, because I'm gonna take one of the suggested sizes here for the A3 paper size, just to have something small. There's no reason, if you have the time obviously, to use something larger for a virtual map if you don't need to print it and put it on a table. So it says for an A3 size map, which would be a 16 by 11 square grid, if a square is an inch, then we should set up an 80 foot by 55 foot map size. And that's what we're going to do. So we're going to click Next. And here we'll put in 80 feet by 55 feet for the map. Now we could go on here and choose a different map round, background, but I'm pretty good with the dirt and grass bitmap. That is the default option, because that's good base to start on for an outdoors map. So we're just going to click finish and I'm going to save the new map. And here's our blank area with the grass and dirt background. So what idea do I want to start our map with? Well, actually, what I'm going to do first, I'm going to put in my grid just to see what goes where and how large everything is. So do I have a reference? Normally, I don't do this for new maps, but since I'm drawing a battle map where distances for combat and stuff will be important, it's nice to put the grid on first. So I'm just going to do draw hex or square overlay from the menu. And here I'm going to go for a square grid with 5 feet to the square. I'm turning off the labels. Don't want any numbers and letters to label the grid. I leave the set snap grid on. Won't probably need it much for this map, but it's always nice to have a grid right away that matches your your visible grid. Apply, and here's my overlay. I'm going to activate sheet effects, have a look at the grid. It does have a grand transparency effect, and if you can see, it softens the grid a little bit, especially if you zoom in. You can see it's not too obvious. Well, you can actually make it a bit less obvious even. If I go into the sheets and effects list, click the transparency effect, click edit, and turn the opacity down to 25%. See, the grid is even less visible. Good, so what kind of area do I want to map? I was thinking of a swampy area, some kind of edge of a swamp, something nasty may crawl out of the waters and out of the mud, and people have to fight it, the PCs. So that's my base idea for the map. We do need a swamp edge, so we do need a watery area first. For that, I'm gonna go to the default water tool here, but I'm not going to left-click it. I don't want the pure blue water. I want something more swampy, dirty. And so I'm going to go for the sludge water. And I'm going to take the darkest option. Click the tool. I'm going to turn off my snap grid because I don't need to put the points exactly on my grid. And I'm going to do perhaps roughly a third in total of the map is of the water. I don't want to cover it too much in water, because that's probably an area that won't see much use directly. It's more useful as a backdrop. And here's my water area. See, it's already a bit blended into the background, so it's just some shallow water where the mud underneath at the bottom is still visible a little, but we are going to draw a second layer for some deeper water. So I'm going to click this again and take a slightly lighter texture and draw a second contour in here. There we go. If I refresh the map now, you can see that I do have a fairly sharp edge to that contour here. That is, the water does have a softened edge here to the land. There's an edge fade effect on this. But since the second contour of the water is on the same sheet, the edge fade is not visible there. To change that, I'm going to move the second contour to its own sheet and apply my own new text edge effect to that. So I'm going to click on the sheets and effects setting again, gonna see where's my water sheet. Here's my water sheet, and I'm gonna add a second one and just simply call it water 2. Gonna take the edge fade effect here, copy it, and paste it on the second one. And then I'm gonna go over here, right click the sheets and effects button. And select the move to sheet command. Gonna select my water contour by clicking on the edge, D for do it, and put it on the other water sheet. So this way, you see we have a soft edge between that and the other water. Good, so that's okay, but I think the edge of the water needs some work. We do need a little bit of transition here in the film because we don't have a very defined water line. We want some swamp and mud where people need to wade through. You know, the boots will get stuck in and others might need to pull them out. So I do want a dark brown outline to the water here. And for that, I'm going to go to the terrain button. That and take a nice dark brown texture and outline this area again. Again, I'm going to simply attach it to the map border, right click to finish, and there's my muddy area. I still want a little more transition between the more grassy area and the dark background and the brown mud. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to put in one of the partially transparent fills. And here we've got, let's take the slightly lighter version. And then again, I'm just going to put this on here. Same procedure. There we are. And I quite like this transition here with the soft blending into the grassy dirt overground and through the partial transparency of the lighter mud, we can see patches of darker mud beneath. I'm quite happy with that effect. So seeing this is the water edge and the muddy area, the center will be the general area where the comet will be happening. So we do need something to make that stand out and have some options for people to fight there. So first thing we're going to do, we're going to put in a path that leads there right to the water's edge. And for that, we're going to take the terrain option again. So we could take some grassy areas. No, but for path it should also be dirt trampled. So we're gonna take a bit of lighter area again. We're just gonna outline this space here at the edge of the water. So, and you see it's on the same sheet as the other dirt area, and this means again that we have a sharp transition between these two textures, something I don't want. So I'm going to move this to a different sheet again. Click move to sheet, select this, D for do it, and instead of the outside sheet where the stuff has been on so far, we're going to take the terrain sheet. Refresh. See, we have a bit of more of a transition here. It's still defined, and that way it's fine. We can clearly see that on the map, but it's not the very straight edge there anymore. Good, so now I set this off. This is still too even here for me, the same repeating texture of grass and dirt. We're going to put in some grassy areas here away from the water. I'm going to click the terrain option again Let's scroll down, and here we're gonna take, well, let's take a little bit darker grass, the 3 version, and just put some grassy patches down here. See, still again, we've got the transition, and again, to maximize the variety in there, we're gonna, like with the mud, we're gonna put on some of the partially transparent grass area on top of the straight green one. There we go. We still got a little bit of repeating texture in here, but we're gonna cover this up with symbols and other features later on. So I'm good with the general texture layout for now. So Sue asked me how I did. Now I changed the crosshairs to pointer. See. Process. That's depending on what tool I use. If I just move the symbols on here, I will just have the pointer. But you can set the options for your pointer, for your mouse here under the options. If I can't find it right now, this is the tooltips. Draw options. Here you can set what kind of cursor you want for the edit commands, whether you want to show all the entities, and options for the display of your cursor options, and whether you want the tooltips on the cursor and stuff is all under tools and options in the menu. All right, so I've got the basic textures down. Now it's time to fill the area with some of the symbols. So I'm thinking my focal point here where the battle takes place will be some old standing stones that are slowly getting swallowed by the swamp. And so we're gonna put in some rocks in first. These you can find in the caves catalog here. Click that. And see, we've got some nice large rocks here. We can use these for the sending stones. So, one in here. Oops, was accidental right click. Go. Down here. This is a bit too much rock for my taste. There we go. And we can. This could have chosen the brown rocks to make it match the mud more, but I did want to highlight these rocks, these standing stones. They should be fairly visible, therefore it's better to take the gray ones, but I also want to scatter some smaller ones around, and for those I'm gonna take the brown version. There we go, and these are much smaller and therefore will not cast such a strong shadow, so we're gonna change to the symbol's flat sheet while placing these, so we don't get the strong shadow effect on them as on the gray ones. Also place a few on the path to show some bigger stones. I'm not taking the largest ones, they are a bit too obvious. So I'm just gonna swap these around as I'm placing them. So there's my circle of stones, of ominous and probably rife with bad magic. So now we do need some vegetation. I do want some trees first, so it's going to be the edge of the forest here. And well, we're gonna pick up some trees. Well, these are under the skirmish symbols. Yeah, these are the ones from Dungeon Designer 3. And for that, we're gonna switch to the symbols trees, because those are large and cast long shadows. Oh, not too many. You don't want to cover your whole map in trees. That way, you will only see the tops of the trees, basically. So this is fine. Or perhaps another smaller one here. Refreshing it will show you that the screen around the map hides the edges of the symbols overlapping the map border. And what you can also do, if you want some variation in the trees, not only the ones from Dungeon Designer, if we click the skirmish symbol again, you will see that we do have some other skirmish vegetation here from one of the earlier annuals. Actually from volume 5, I think. So we're going to click this. And this is a nice large variety of different trees and vegetation and vines for going around pillars and some ferns and stuff. A very nice variation of trees, which still blend quite well with Dungeon Designer 3 trees. So let's grab one of the trees here. See, these are fairly large, so we don't want too many of those. We can even decrease their size a little bit so they don't dominate our map too much. One of these and one of these up here, and that should be fine. See, this is so large that it even overlaps the screen, the map screen, a little bit, but since we'll be exporting this anyway to, and not printing it or using it on screen within Campaign Cut Offer, I'm not worried about this. I'll just leave that as is. So we've got the trees down. Next up, we're going to switch to the normal symbols sheet and go to our bushes. Scatter some of these around. See, since they are on the symbol below the trees, if you refresh, you'll see that the bushes automatically go below the trees. And again, we can go to our annual style to grab some of the bushes here, which are also very nice. Add some variety in different colors. Oh, that wasn't a bush, that was a tree. Okay, looks good. And now for basically I was thinking of three layers of foliage in the map. The highest are the treetops, the trees, below that are the bushes and smaller trees, and then we've got weeds and grasses and stuff like that. I'll put this in last, and this goes on the symbols flat sheet. And again, let's go through the Dungeon Designer. And first, this unfortunately doesn't have that much variation in shrubs. There's only two of those, but they are nice, weedy looking things that go nicely on the water's edge. You know, imagine reeds and grasses growing along the edge of the swamp. You can also change the color to something brownish, or perhaps something a little bit darker, and put some brownish grayish weeds in to mingle with the green ones. And then switch to our other catalog, and size could make this a little bit smaller for these symbols, let's say 6 2/3, and put in some ferns. These These can also go underneath the trees. Some nice colorful fungi in here. They always look good on a fantasy map. Set this back to normal size. And go back to our Dungeon Designer catalog. Oh, actually, yeah, we've got some fungi in there too, but those are in the cave catalog. Let's see, we've got some toadstools here, different colors. Oh, this actually has some varicolor, so let's not make the spots green. Instead, let them keep red. Yes, always look nice hidden underneath the trees, just peeking out little places. And there we are. Oh, it doesn't look too bad, does it? So what we can also do is, what I'm thinking is that something crawls out of the water occasionally and leave some pools of slime. First hint for the players to see that something's really amiss. And we have some nice looking slime symbols in Dungeon Designer. And let's put something here at the water's edge, below the stones. And then we might want to show, actually, this is more on top of the water. We might want to show that it's extending below the water surface. So, but we do need a new symbol sheet for that, because at the moment we have nothing that is below the water. So what we're gonna do, we're just gonna add a new sheet, symbols underwater. Move this up so it's below the water sheet. And again, I'm going to right click here to use move to sheet. Oops, that was the grid I accidentally selected. So I'm going to do not and deselect the grid. Do it and move the slime to the symbols on the water sheet. See, and you can now, if I zoom in, that the slime is nicely below the water. Let's continue that and do a little more stuff underwater. Show that this extends here. Refresh. Let's see, it's nicely under the murky surface. So, thinking we might need some tracks, perhaps. The wagon tracks would not be appropriate here on this path to the swamp's edge. That would be very unusual. Well, perhaps there might be if you think of a reason, but I'm not going to do wagon tracks. Instead, I'm just going to put down some track symbols of footprints, because we've got some nice ones in here in the Dungeon Designer debris catalog. So I'm just gonna put these down. Oh, but I'm on the underwater sheet. This is not where I want to go. So actually, perhaps these are still a little bit too obvious for me, so I'm gonna put in further symbols sheet, symbols tracks. And I'm going to put the footsteps on that. That way I'm also making sure they are not hiding the stones too much. Go. I'm just going to stuff in here. And perhaps the our PCs are... first, I did want to make these a little bit less obvious, so what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna add a transparency effect. Transparency 50%, let's have a look. Oh, actually I might again... running into the problem that this doesn't work on symbols. Right. True enough about that. So symbols are not all sheet effects can be used on symbols themselves because they're displayed in a certain manner. So we're gonna have to live with the effects, the tracks as they are here for the moment. So instead, what we're gonna add, a corpse here at the center of our attention. We do have a better looking corpse up here. There we go. Something bleeding, something nasty has happened to this poor fellow. I'm going to put him on the symbols flat sheet. There we go. Put him here so the heroes might be on the track of him, find him dead, and then something nasty crawls out of the swamp they have to fight. Okay, this looks like a good battle map to play with. So let's see. Let's save the map first, and now we're gonna look at exporting it. Zoom in. So the first thing I do is here we have the combat grid on the map, and if we were printing the map, this would might be nice to have on there, print with it, but all the virtual tabletop softwares usually have their own grid to put over the map. And this will clash with the grid we have on our map, so I usually always export this for virtual tabletop use without the grid visible. So I'm just gonna hide the grid. Okay. So before we go on, let's have a look. We have a suggestion from Next Level 88, putting darker color vegetation under the transparent water sheet and smaller, lighter color vegetation above the water is a neat way to make it look like weeds grown out of the water. That's actually quite nice. Nice idea. So let's try that a little bit. Let's go to the underwater sheet. Go back to our weeds here. Let's use some dark bluish green, dark green, and put some of that on more on the edge of the water here. And then use some lighter color. Oops, go to the normal symbols flat sheet. Put that above the water here. That looks nice. Good stuff. But short distraction. And so on. Let's export the map. For this, we're gonna right-click the save button and choose export rectangular section. It circumvents the dialog, which I don't want. We're just gonna use save as, and we're gonna go to rectangular section JPEG. Going to use the JPEG just because it's quicker to import into the virtual tabletops later. Click the options button here is your friend because it lets you set the size of your map. So let's undo the settings we have here. So we just are gonna start from fresh, because I already had set the option as I needed them, but that you will probably not have that exactly as you need when you go to the save as options. So we need to set these. Now we're gonna make use of some of the stuff we know about the map, basically how large it is, and so to get the correct size. So from the start, when we created the map, we know it's 80 feet by 55 feet in size, and the usual scale is 5 feet to a 1 inch grid. That was also shown in the new map template. We know the map is 16 inches across and 11 inches high. So my 580 feet by 55 feet. And then we do need to know the usual pixel per inch size the maps use on the virtual tabletops, but very commonly that's 150 pixel per inch. Oh, I should have done that first. Sorry about that, because now I have to put in the width and height again. So I want 16 inches and 11 inches height. And there you can see it sets the width and height I need for my export to the values I need. So I need to export it by at 2400 by 1650 pixels. So I don't need any extra calculation or anything. And the alias of 50% is really too much. We just need a little. You should do something like 10% to smooth out some stuff. The difference will, on this type of map, will not be very noticeable anyway. I'm not going to crop the image aspect ratio, so I keep the size here. And I don't need, I can set restrict image to my border, but I'm going to do a rectangular section anyway, so, and I'm using the map border for that, so this really doesn't matter whether I set it or don't. And then what I would do is I would save these settings for future use. So just click the save button here and call it my battle map scale. This would naturally only be the correct values for a map of this size. If you do use a different size, you need to set the width and height again and calculate the pixel size from that. Well, CC3+ will calculate the pixel size from that. But it gives you a good starting point. So, okay. We'll save this as the swamp. Save. And now I'm going to pick the corners here, because I'm using a rectangular section. I often do that just to have precise control over what section I want to export, because sometimes I don't want to export everything. But here I'm just going to use the endpoint modifier by pressing F5, click this corner, use F5 again, and choose the bottom right corner. And then you can see the rendering export window comes up. And the export is fairly quick. And I've set the external viewer to load, so it will load up my Photoshop. And here's my map. I could now do stuff in Photoshop here if I want to adjust hue, saturation, contrast or anything, or crop the image further, but I'm fine with that at this point. So I'm just going to use the map. So I'm just going to close it down. And now I'm going to go to the virtual tabletops. I'm going to show you Roll20 and Fantasy Grounds, because basically those are the two I have and sometimes use Roll20 a lot more than Fantasy Grounds. But there's lots more around. We've got an article about virtual tabletops on the blog. And this is not to say that these are the best or anything. This is just the two ones I am halfway familiar with, so I'm using them. And let's load up Roll20. Roll20 is browser-based, So you just go to the Roll20.net website and can create scenarios and sessions there. And I've already loaded up a session. And in here, you've got this simple grid always in the background where you can place maps and other stuff on. So it's very simple. You just go to your library up here and then click the upload button. And then you choose a file. And I'm in my videos and Pro Fantasy streams. We are on working on the battle maps. No, actually, I didn't save my map here. So I need to check where I actually saved my map. Huh. Thought I was working in the video session. So to do that, I just go into the campaign cartograph again and choose File Save As. And okay, I see I've saved the map in my downloads folder. So let's go back here, choose the downloads folder, and here's my swamp. It's gonna take a moment to upload. Unfortunately, Roll20 doesn't have a very good indicator on when the upload progresses and when it is visible. Didn't that work? Let's try again. There we are. Well, I uploaded it twice now, actually, but no, doesn't matter. And here I've got it in my uploads, and I can just pull the map here on my map background. And I already forgot something. Let's undo this, erase this, because I need to set my layer to the map and background. Sorry, I've actually got my Roll20 set to German, but this is the map and background layer, the first one in the list here. Now I'm gonna take my swamp up here, place this, and now I can pull it large. And I know I've got 16 by 11 squares to fill, so 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, need to zoom out a bit, 16, and I've got 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, well, have a quick look, 4, 8, 12, 16, 4, 8, 11, yeah, that looks good. And here I've got my map. If I go to the objects and tokens layer now, I can place stuff like monsters on here. Actually, this is a large monster that takes up several spaces. I have a hydra, and I can now move this on the map and use it in the battles I'm running on Roll20. And yeah, you can see Roll20 has its own grid here, looks fairly very similar to what I did in Campaign Cartographer, but not exporting it with the rest of the map from Campaign Cartographer makes sure that those two don't clash with each other. So that's all you've got to do in Roll20. Depending on which version of Roll20 you have, there's additional options like doing dynamic lighting and stuff. But I'm not going to give you a Roll20 tutorial here, just a quick showing how to import the stuff. There's lots of tutorials for Roll20 and other virtual tabletops around on YouTube and the internet. And check those out if you're interested in running online sessions via these. Good, so that was Roll20. Now let's go to the other one I wanted to show you. That's Fantasy Grounds. Roll20 is its own application. It's not browser-based, so it works a little bit differently to start. It's a separate install, but it does have the prettier interface, as you can see. It's depending on what modules you load, you get very elaborate interfaces and stuff. But that also means it's a bit more difficult to use than Roll20, at least in my experience. What we get if we load up or start a new module for Roll20, for Fantasy Grounds, sorry, you get this. This is sort of D&D 5th edition module. That's basics for a Dungeons and Dragons game, and there you've got the options here like maps and stuff on the right side. So I can just, if I want to add a map, I click on the map button here, and there you can see I get some example images that it's in, but to import stuff I need to copy it to the modules folder, and this can be a bit hard to find sometimes, except you can do so from within Fantasy Grounds. You just click on the folder here and that opens up your Windows Explorer with the folder where images should go, and that means I can open up another Windows Explorer folder with my downloads folder. I saved my swamp. And then I'm just gonna copy the, oops, that's a bit too far, the swamp over here. Go to Fantasy Grounds, and you see the swamp shows up in the list. And if I open that, I get this nice look at the map close up right away. Now I want a grid on this map, and Fantasy Grounds lets you define the grid size visually. And what you do, you right click on the map, and then you go to the layers options, and here you can set the grid. Click that, and then you just click on the maps somewhere, leave the map button the left mouse button pressed, and open up, and you basically define one square on the map, or how large a square should be. And here the number you see in this square is the number of pixels it will be. So we know we had 150 pixel per inch per square, so we're just going to set that to 150. And there is our grid on the map. Again, very similar to what we had in Campaign Cartographer. So if I... There's the map here. And it's in the background. And again, now you can go in here and... if I can remember this, no, it's not in encounters, I think it's in NPCs. Yeah, here you've got different monsters in here, say an ancient black dragon. No, that's actually just a pin for this. Right, I need tokens on the map. This is, you see, I'm much less familiar with Fantasy Grounds than with Roll20. Got the tokens up here, and you've got monster tokens, and here is stuff that you can place on the map. Different monsters. Got a Naga warrior here that we can grab, put on the map. You can, if you release the token scale, they are larger. And you can move these around on the map. See, it's a bit prettier, the whole interface, but also a little bit more tricky than Roll20. You can rotate these. Oops. Move them around the map. That's what the... this way, if you release the scale, it will... not scale the monster tokens together with the map. So let's, if we lock the token scale at this size, then we can zoom in and out of the map without changing the size of the monster. Okay, And that's all there's to it, really. You've got your map on Fantasy Grounds or on World 20. The Foundry is a very popular one these days. There's lots of other stuff around. You find something to your needs, whether it's paid for or free, or how much you want to pay, how much control about customization you want in your virtual tabletop. And luckily, well, it's not the same for me, at least, as doing face-to-face meetings for playing games, but it's a workable alternative in these difficult times. So let's go back to Roll20, and I see Quentin asked about the monster counters. The one I shown Fantasy Grounds was ones that came with the program itself, but the one here in Roll20 is one from our Token Treasury set. So that's one I just imported earlier. You can basically import tokens in a similar way in Roll20 than I did as I did with the map. And these, as you can see, are also freely scalable. And movable around the map. All right. So if there's any more questions, please ask them now, because I'm run out of stuff I wanted to do in tonight's session. I've created the whole map and reported both in Roll20 and Fantasy Grounds, all just under an hour. So that's good night's work, I think. Okay, map tool gets mentioned in the comments. Yes, that's another great tool. I haven't used this actually myself, but heard good things about that. And well, might check it out. At the moment, I run my games with Roll20, and that works reasonably well. Though I'd love a little more customization options, but I'm doing good. All right, people, that was it for tonight. Thank you very much for listening, for following me along, for your nice comments in the chat. And just wanted to mention that we've got the Black Friday sale going on at the moment. Check out our website, our web store. Everything is off 50% at the moment. So if you need to grab something, this is a good time to do so. And I read you on the forum, on Facebook, and see you again here next week. Have a good night and stay healthy, everybody. Bye-bye.